continuing and probably concluding Sartorius from Plutarch's Lives, translated by John Dryden, revised by Arthur Hugh Clough. The battle near Sucro was fought, it is said, through the impatience of Pompey, lest Metellus should share with him in the victory. Sertorius, being also willing to engage Pompey before the arrival of Metellus, Sertorius delayed the time till the evening, considering that the darkness of the night would be a disadvantage to his enemies, whether flying or pursuing, being strangers and having no knowledge of the country. When the fight began, it happened that Sertorius was not placed directly against Pompey, but against Afranius, who had command of the left wing. When he understood that his left wing began to give way and yield to the assaults of Pompey, he committed the care of his right wing to other commanders and made haste to relieve those in distress, and rallying some that were flying and encouraging others that still kept their ranks, he renewed the fight and attacked the enemy in their pursuit so effectively as to cause a considerable rout and brought Pompey into great danger of his life. For after being wounded and losing his horse, he escaped unexpectedly. For the Africans with Sertorius, who took Pompey's horse, set out with gold covered with rich trappings, fell out with one another, and upon the dividing of the spoil gave over the pursuit. Afranius, in the meantime, as soon as Sertorius had left his right wing to assist the other part of his camp, overthrew all that opposed him, and pursuing them to their camp, fell in together with them, and plundered them till it was dark night. Knowing nothing of Pompey's overthrow, nor being able to restrain his soldiers from pillaging, when Sertorius, returning with victory, fell upon him and upon his men, who were all in disorder, and slew many of them. And the next morning he came into the field again, well armed, and offered battle. But perceiving that Metellus was near, he drew off and returned to his camp, saying, "If this old woman had not come up, I would have whipped that boy soundly and sent him to Rome." He was much concerned that his white hind could nowhere be found, as he was thus destitute of an admirable contrivance to encourage the barbarous people at a time when he most stood in need of it. Some men, however, wandering in the night, chanced to meet her, and knowing her by her color, took her, to whom Sertorius promised a good reward if they would tell no one of it, and immediately shut her up. A few days after, he appeared in public with a very cheerful look, and declared to the chief men of the country that the gods had foretold him in a dream that some great good fortune should be shortly attended him, and, taking his seat, proceeded to answer the petitions of those who applied themselves to him. Now, some people are telling the truth that they really are judging it to have been as such, but people will misuse situations like that to lie about spiritual experience. And in India and also in Europe, there were rituals where they let animals wander loose and either leave them alone and we won't go to war with you was basically the main thing. But there was tended to be more to it. The keepers of the hind, who were not far off, now let her loose, and she no sooner espied Sertorius, but she came leaping with great joy to his feet, laid her head upon his knees, looked at his hands, as she formerly used to do, and Sertorius stroking her, and making much of her again, with that tenderness that the tears stood in his eyes, all that were present immediately filled with wonder and astonishment, and accompanying him to his house, with loud shouts for joy, looked upon him as a person above the rank of mortal men, and highly beloved by the entities and were in great courage and hope for the future. When he had reduced his enemies to the last extremity, for want of provision, he was forced to give them battle in the plains near Saguntum to hinder them from foraging and plundering the country. Both parties fought gloriously. Memmius, the best commander in Pompey's army, was slain in the heat of the battle. Sertorius overthrew all before him, and with great slaughter of his enemies, pressed forward towards Metellus. This old commander, making a resistance beyond what could be expected from one of his years, he wounded with a lance, an occurrence which filled all who either saw it or heard of it with shame, to be thought to have left their general in distress, but at the same time to provoke them to revenge and fury against their enemies. They covered Metellus with their shields and brought him off in safety, and then valiantly repulsed the Spaniards, and so victory changed sides in Sertorius that he might afford a more secure retreat to his army, and that fresh forces might more easily be raised, retired into a strong city in the mountains. And he thought it was the least of the intention to sustain a long siege, yet he began to repair the walls and fortify the gates, thus deluding his enemies, who came and sat down before the town, hoping to take it without much resistance, and meantime gave over the pursuit of the Spaniards and allowed opportunity for raising new forces for Sertorius, to which purpose he had sent commanders to all their cities with orders that they had sufficiently increased their numbers to send him word of it. This news he no sooner received, but he sallied out and forced his way through his enemies and easily joined them with the rest of his army. Having received this considerable reinforcement, he set upon the Romans again, and by rapidly assaulting them, by alarming them on all sides, by ensnaring, circumventing, and laying ambushes for them, he cut off all provisions by land, while with his piratical vessels he kept all the coast in awe, and hindered their supplies by sea. He thus forced the Roman generals to dislodge and to separate from one another. Metellus departed into Gaul, and Pompey wintered among the Vacaans in a wretched condition, where, being in extreme want of money, he wrote a letter to the Senate to let them know that if they did not speedily support him, he must draw off his army, for he had already spent his own money in the defense of Italy. To these extremities, the chiefest and most powerful commanders of the age were reduced by the skill of Sertorius, and it was the common opinion in Rome that he would be in Italy before Pompey. How far Metellus was terrified, and at what rate he esteemed him, he plainly declared when he offered by proclamation 100 talents and 20,000 acres of land to any Roman that should kill him and leave, if he were banished, to return, attempting villainously to buy his life by treachery when he despaired of ever being able to overcome him in open war. When once he gained the advantage in a battle against Sertorius, he was so pleased and transported with his good fortune that he caused himself to be publicly proclaimed imperator, and that all the cities which he visited received him with altars and sacrifices. He allowed himself, it is said, to have garlands placed on his head, and accepted sumptuous entertainments at which he sat drinking in triumphal robes, while images and figures of victory were introduced by the motion of machines, bringing in with them crowns and trophies of gold to present to him, and companies of young men and women danced before him and sang to him songs of joy and triumph, by all which he rendered himself deservedly ridiculous for being so excessively delighted and puffed up with the thoughts of having followed one who was retiring of his own accord, and for having once had the better of him who had used to call Sulla's runaway slave and his forces the remnant of the defeated troops of Carbo. Sertorius, meantime, showed the loftiness of his temper in calling together all the Roman senators who had fled from Rome and had come and resided with him, and giving them the name of a senate, and out of those he chose proctors and quaestors, and adorned his government with all the Roman laws and institutions, and, though he made use of the arms, riches, and cities of the Spaniards, yet he would never, even in word, remit to them the imperial authority, but set Roman officers and commanders over them, intimating his purpose to restore liberty to the Romans, not to raise up the Spaniards' power against them, for he was a sincere lover of his country, and had a great desire to return home, but in his adverse fortune he showed undaunted courage, and behaved himself towards his enemies in a manner free from all dejection and mean-spiritedness, and when he was in his prosperity and in the height of his victories, he sent word to Metellus and Pompey that he was ready to lay down his arms and live a private life if he were allowed to return home, declaring that he had rather live with the meanest citizens in Rome, exiled from it, be supreme commander of all the cities together. And it is thought that his great desire for his country was in no small measure promoted by the tenderness that he had for his mother, under whom he was brought up after the death of his father, and upon whom he had placed entire affection. After that, his friends had sent for him into Spain to be their general. As soon as he heard of his mother's death, he had almost cast away himself and died for grief, for that he lay 7 days together continually in his tent, without giving the word or being seen by the nearest of his friends, when the chief commanders of the army and persons of the greatest note came about his tent. With great difficulty they prevailed with him at last to come abroad and speak with his soldiers, and to take upon him the management of affairs which were in a prosperous condition, and thus to many men's judgment he seemed to have been in himself of a mild and compassionate temper, and naturally given to ease and quietness, and have accepted of the command of the military forces, contrary to his own inclination, and not being able to live in safety otherwise, and have been driven by his enemies to have recourse to arms and espouse the wars as a necessary guard for the defense of his person. His negotiations with King Mithridates further argue the greatness of his mind. When Mithridates, recovering himself from his overthrow by Sulla, like a strong wrestler that gets up to try another fall, was again endeavoring to reestablish his power in Asia. At this time, the great fame of Sertorius was celebrated in all places, and when the merchants who came out of the western parts of Europe, bringing these, as it were, among their other foreign wares, had filled the kingdom of Pontus with their stories of his exploits in war, Mithridates was extremely desirous to send an embassy to him, being also highly encouraged to it by the boastings of his flattering courtiers, who, comparing Mithridates to Parrhas and Sertorius to Hannibal, professed that the Romans would never be able to make any considerable resistance against such great forces and such admirable commanders, when they should be set up on both sides at once, on one by the most warlike general, and on the other by the most powerful prince in existence. Accordingly, Mithridates sent ambassadors into Spain to Sertorius with letters and instructions, and commissioned to promise ships and money toward the charge of the war if Sertorius would confirm his pretensions upon Asia and authorize him to possess all that he had surrendered to the Romans. In his treaty with Sulla, Sertorius summoned a full council, which he called a senate, where others joyfully approved of the conditions and were desirous immediately to accept his offer, seeing that he desired nothing of them but a name and an empty title to places not in their power to dispose of, in recompense of which they should be supplied with what they then stood most in need of. Sertorius would by no means agree to it, declaring that he was willing that King Mithridates should exercise all royal power and authority over Bithynia and Cappadocia, countries accustomed to a monarchical government, and not belonging to Rome, but he could never consent that he should seize or detain a province which, by the justice right and title, was possessed by the Romans, which Mithridates had formerly taken away from them, and had afterwards lost in open war to Fimbria, and quitted upon a territory, a treaty of peace with Sulla, for he looked upon it as his duty to enlarge the Roman possessions by his conquering arms, and not to increase his own power by the diminution of the Roman territories, since a noble-minded man, though he willingly accepts a victory when it comes with honor, will never so much as endeavor to save his own life upon any dishonorable terms. When this was related to Mithridates, he was struck with amazement and said to his intimate friends, "What will Sertorius enjoin us to do when he comes to be seated in the Palatium in Rome, who at present, when he is driven out to the borders of the Atlantic Sea, sets bounds to our kingdoms in the east, and threatens us with war when we attempt the recovery of Asia?" Now, Asia is not the continent, Asia, and it's called the Atlantic because Atlantis was the Berbers say their prehistoric ruler founder was, and so that trans African continent clear down into Sudan and stuff, Sudan, Egypt, and basically Mauritania, life, the Sahara. It wasn't this undersea kingdom or whatever that people say. However, they solemnly upon oath concluded a league between them upon these terms, that Mithridates should enjoy the free possession of Cappadocia and Bithynia, and that Sertorius should send him soldiers and a general for his army, in recompense of which the king was to supply him with 3,000 talents and 40 ships. Marcus Marius, a Roman senator who had quitted Rome to follow Sertorius, was sent general into Asia, in company with whom, when Mithridates had reduced diverse of the Asian cities, Marius made his entrance with rods and axes carried before him, and Mithridates followed in the second place, voluntarily waiting upon him. Some of these he set at liberty, and others he freed from taxes, signifying to them that these privileges were granted to them by the favor of Sertorius, and hereby Asia, which had been miserably tormented by the revenue farmers and oppressed by the insolent pride and covetousness of the soldiers, began to rise again to new hopes and to look forward with joy to the expected change of government. But in Spain, the senators about Sertorius and others of the nobility, finding themselves strong enough for their enemies, no sooner laid aside fear, but their minds were possessed by envy and irrational jealousness of Sertorius's power, and chiefly Perpenna, elevated by the thoughts of his noble birth and carried away with the fond ambition of commanding the army, threw out villainous discourses in private amongst his acquaintance. "What evil genius," he would say, "hurries us perpetually from worse to worse? We, who disdained to obey the dictates of Sulla, the ruler of sea and land, and thus to live at home in peace and quiet, and come hither to our destruction, hoping to enjoy our liberty, and have made ourselves slaves of our own accord, and are become contemptible guards and attendants of the banished Sertorius, who, that he may espouse us the further, gives us a name that renders us ridiculous to all who hear it, and calls us the Senate, when at the same time he makes us undergo as much hard labor and forces us to be as subject to his haughty commands and insolences as any Spaniards and Lusitanians. With these mutinous discourses he seduced them, and though the greater number could not be led into open rebellion against Sertorius, fearing his power, they were prevailed with to endeavor to destroy his interest secretly, for by abusing the Lusitanians and Spaniards, by inflicting severe punishments upon them, by raising exorbitant taxes, and by pretending that all this was done By the strict command of Sertorius, they caused great troubles and made many cities to revolt, and those that were sent to mitigate and heal these differences did rather exasperate them and increase the number of his enemies, and left them at their return more obstinate and rebellious than they found them. And Sertorius, incensed with all this, now so far forgot his former clemency and goodness as to lay hands on the sons of the Spaniards educated in the city of Osca, and to contrary all justice, and cruelly put some of them to death, and sold others. In the meantime, Perpenna, having increased the number of his conspirators, drew in Manlius, a commander of the army, who at that time, being attached to a youth, to gain his affections the more, discovered the confederacy to him, bidding him neglect others and be constant to him alone, who in a few days was to be a person of great power and authority. But the youth, having a greater inclination for Aphidius, disclosed all to him, which much surprised and amazed him, for he was also one of the confederacy, but knew not that Manlius was any ways engaged in it. But when the youth began to name Perpenna, Gracchinus, and others, whom he knew very well to be sworn conspirators, he was very much terrified and astonished, but made light of it to the youth, and bade him not to regard what Manlius said, a vain boasting fellow. However, he went presently to Perpenna, and giving him notice of the danger they were in, and of the shortness of their time, desired him immediately to put their designs in execution. When all the confederates had consented to it, they provided a messenger who brought feigned letters to Sertorius, in which he had notice of a victory obtained, it said, by one of his lieutenants, and of the great slaughter of his enemies. And as Sertorius, being extremely well pleased, was sacrificing and giving thanks to what he considered to be gods and goddesses for his prosperous success, Perpenna invented him and those with him, who were also of the conspiracy, to an entertainment, and being very importunate, prevailed with him to come at all suppers and entertainments where Sertorius was present. Great order and decency was wont to be observed, for he would not endure to hear or see anything that was rude or unhandsome, but made it the habit of all who kept his company to entertain themselves with quite an inoffensive amusements. But in the middle of his entertainment, those who sought occasion to quarrel fell into dissolute discourse openly, and making as if they were very drunk, committed many insolences on purpose to provoke him. Sertorius, being offended with their ill behavior, or perceiving the state of their minds by the way of speaking an unusually disrespectful manner, changed the posture of his lying and leaned backwards as one that neither heard nor regarded them. Perpenna now took a cup full of wine, and as he was drinking, let it fall out of his hand, and made a noise, which was the sign agreed upon amongst them. And Antonius, who was next to Sertorius, immediately wounded him with his sword, and whilst Sertorius, upon receiving the wound, turned himself, and strove to get up, Antonius threw himself upon his breast, and held both his hands, so that he died by a number of blows, without being able even to defend himself. Upon the first news of his death, most of the Spaniards left the conspirators and sent ambassadors to Pompey and Metellus, and yielded themselves up to them. Perpenna attempted to do something with those that remained, but he made only so much use of Sertorius's arms and preparations for war as to disgrace himself in them, and to let it be evident to all that he understood no more how to command than he knew how to obey. And when he came against Pompey, he was soon overthrown and taken prisoner. Neither did he bear this last affection with any bravery, but having Sertorius's papers and writings in his hands, he offered to show Pompey's letters from persons of consular dignity and of the highest quality in Rome, written with their own hands, expressly to call Sertorius into Italy and to let him know what great numbers there were that earnestly desired to alter the present state of affairs and to introduce another manner of government. Upon this occasion, Pompey behaved not like a youth or one of a like inconsiderate mind, but as a man of confirmed, mature, and solid judgment, and so freed Rome from great fears and dangers of change, for he put all Sertorius' writings and letters together and read not one of them, nor suffered anyone else to read them, but burnt them all and caused Perpenna immediately to be put to death, lest by discovering their names, further troubles and revolutions might ensue. The rest of the conspirators with Perpenna, some were taken and slain by the command of Pompey, others fled into Africa and were set upon by the Moors and run through with their darts, and in a short time not one of them was left alive, except only Aufidius, the rival of Manlius, who, hiding himself, or not being much inquired after, died an old man in an obscure village in Spain in extreme poverty and hated by all. Well, obviously they still knew who he was, right?